My name is Alan Smithson. I'm super honored and excited to be hosting this panel today. Music is one of my major passions in life. I actually have a tattoo of a 45 adapter on my arm. I've been a DJ. I was a DJ for 20 years. I retired a couple of years ago. And I founded the Emulator, which was a giant see-through touchscreen DJ controller, and got to work with some of the biggest artists in the world. And most recently, actually on New Year's Eve, Jean-Michel Jarre hosted a virtual concert and used the Emulator in it. So it was kind of like, wow. You know, I started working with Jean-Michel Jarre probably 6 years ago before I got into VR. I was very, very lucky. In 2014, I got invited to perform on the Emulator at Curiosity Camp by Eric Schmidt. And at the same camp, there was a gentleman named Chris Milk. And Chris Milk is a music producer. He's produced a bunch of YouTube videos. So he produced a number of amazing music videos, and one of them was in 360, and I got to try VR for the first time. I was standing on stage with Beck, and it was that transformative moment that changed my life, because I tried it. I went, this is the future of human communication. This is not just a cool thing to show concerts. And I dedicated my life since then to XR, or virtual augmented mixed reality. And I assume there's a Nexus story for you guys as well. So I'm going to introduce John. John McInnes is the founder of McInnes Studios, and we'll get into the work he does very soon. We have Tim Dillon, the Senior Vice President of Growth at Media Monks, and Ollie Rankin is the CEO at Pan Sensory Interactive. And I want to welcome you guys. Thank you so much for joining us on this panel today.
Great to be here.
Hey, everybody.
Excited. So we'll start with John. John, what was your nexus into kind of the virtual space, and how did you go from, you know, what you were doing before, or have you always been in virtual productions, and how did you get into this industry, and what are you doing now?
By accident, I think. My background is as a screenwriter. I came to Hollywood as a screenwriter. I was an award-winning movie screenwriter, and I was hired to write Call of Duty Advanced Warfare, the video game that came out in 2014. That was my introduction to all things virtual, all things to do with games and game engines. I was considering myself a complete outsider to the visual effects world. But that in itself was a massive education, you know, to be working on the most cutting edge video game of its time, you know, specifically working with digital human characters and photoreal environments. You know, Kevin Spacey was the Hollywood talent that was hired as our main bad guy. So I became very intrigued, and also, I mean, you know, hands-on for 2 years sort of working with that team up there and what the possibilities of it was. And then VR kicked off pretty much immediately after that with the Oculus acquisition, which sort of really kick-started VR, and everybody's super excited about VR and thought, this is awesome. I've just spent all this time working on Call of Duty doing this stuff, and VR seems to be the next logical kind of way to go. And actually, music was particularly appropriate for this medium as a way of sort of spearheading what was possible within the medium. And when I came off of Call of Duty, I knew Dave Stewart of the Eurythmics, that guys on the panel here will know who he is, but band back in the early 80s, who was very, very significant and innovative, and an amazing guy, very creative guy. And always interested in technology. He was very interested in doing stuff. So we were trying to do some stuff in VR. That didn't quite happen, but I made a demo called Grace, who is behind us now. We wanted to do like a photoreal character that was really prove what you could do within the music space within room scale VR. So we made this demo that was then used by the likes of AMD, NVIDIA, HTC to sort of demonstrate what you could do within the music space. I think it was nominated for a Lumia Award and a Proto Award and various things, and sort of laid the groundwork for certain, you know, music performances within the space. But that's how the company started. And I'd say ever since, I've been sort of always been doing virtual reality, augmented reality, but now returning back into movies, because all of these things sort of become one. You know, the common factor is the game engine. I've been working with Unreal for the last, you know, 5 or 6 years, the whole time. Media itself, it's not sort of separated off. It's all becoming sort of, you know, what you can do with the tools available.
It's interesting that you touch on game engines. You know, a game engine 5 years ago was, something you built a game on, and maybe, an enterprise solution. But now, you know, Unreal Engine's powering Hollywood movies, you know, AAA games. It's powering virtual reality training at airlines. Like, the game engines have really become the central source of creation tool, or the central creation tool. What are some of the other tools that you're, you know, using in around those to create these virtual humans and virtual spaces?
Is that to me or to
you? Yeah. And then we'll move on from there. It's kind of
interesting because, you know, when we first started out, we were like, oh, are we going to use Unity or Unreal? We went with Unreal at the time, this is 5 years ago or so, because of the graphic fidelity advantage. But, you know, the last 5 years for Epic and Unreal has been really amazing in that, of course, they've made great advancements with their own engine. But, you know, a lot of that's been fueled by Fortnite. You know, Fortnite cash money, you know, injection into this, plus their successes, you know, working, you know, spreading out within the games ecosystem, but also into, you know, in VR, into movies. But I think it's been really good having the success of Fortnite and the money to kind of accelerate these technologies and what's possible with the technologies. And I also think it's very important to remember that, you know, we're talking about technologies and tools, but the acceleration and adoption of these tools is really based around content, you know, i.e. Fortnite. You know, without Fortnite, would you have this massive adoption? Would you have the money to sort of accelerate this sort of stuff? Would people be having this same conversation? You know, would Epic be about to be launching, you know, Unreal 5? You know, what would that look like without that enormous success that they've had? And I think that's really, really key, because there's all this focus on, you know, the tools, what it is. But for me, I'm a creator, and it comes down to, well, what are you going to do with these tools? And you're only going to have success with these tools if you make something pretty phenomenal that people use and consume. And I think that's partly been the hurdle in the whole equation with VR and virtual production, all of these things. And I'm really excited, because I really feel we're on the sort of tipping point where it's going to become very rapidly about what you make, not how you make it. And I think Epic have been absolutely at the tip of the spear of doing this. You know, even as I say, like before we came on, you know, the Meta Humans initiative. I mean, you know, that's been coming for a while. I mean, as soon as Epic bought 3Lateral and Cubix, like it's inevitable. And I absolutely welcome it, because I really want more creators creating with, you know, using these tools, because that's when it's going to become really relevant and significant within the culture, where it just becomes like, this is how you make something. It's not like, oh, this is a game engine and how we can, it's just going to be like, well, this is a creative tool that many, many, many people can use.
Yeah, akin to Photoshop for 3D.
Yeah, absolutely.
Make it easy. All right, moving over to you, Tim. You have decades of experience in this industry. So how did you get into kind of the virtual side of things?
Always makes me feel old when people say decades, but I'll take it.
Hey man, we all got gray hairs, brother. We earned every one of them, I'm sure.
Yeah, I started, actually, it's interesting hearing you talk about being a DJ, because you reminded me, so was I. And this is back to being a teenager and loving music and growing up in the UK and around London, where the dance scene and the electronic EDM scene was very strong and a lot of roots over there. So yeah, I grew up that way too. So always had that in my DNA, but then became a designer, graphic designer, interactive designer through Flash, and spent 10 years designing in the UK and Europe. But actually eventually felt that design, although still a big passion for me, I wanted to be closer to the business side of things, and in the center of where decisions were being made about projects, and also saw that projects don't always get made if you don't have the right business people, business in a loose terms, you know, actually in the center of things. So I think I see it as a mix of creative, technical, and business, which really drives a lot of the best projects that we all see and get to work on. So I worked with this great company in London who are still amazing. It was almost 15 years ago for me now, called Nexus Animation. And Nexus are an amazing character animation studio over there in London, and they work all over the world. And then I joined MPC, Moving Picture Company, which I started to work with them in New York around experiential. So we'd be doing projection mapping and all of 3D projection mapping. So putting a lot of this design language into good use. And of course, when VR came along, I was working with some of the early creators. And it's interesting, you mentioned Chris and the U2 project. That was a project I worked on with him as the post-production side of his what was called at the time Verse.
Verse, VRSE.
And then became Within, and everything that he's doing now with Supernatural and the wellness apps and the things they're doing in VR, which is super interesting and successful. So those early 360 videos that Chris and a lot of the creators, Garbo, Aurora, all these people were making, really were great experiments. And even then, actually, in parallel to that, creating game engine experiences alongside, so doing things for PlayStation. I worked a lot with Sony Music back then. So when the VR boom started again, when was this? Probably 2015, 2016 now. So the recent uptick. And I enjoyed doing a few projects with Sony. One particular one was for Kygo. And we launched that PlayStation. And that was a really good experiment in what it means to take a short form, real-time music video to PlayStation, which is not always the easiest thing to do, right? Because it's a game platform and that's not what it's there for. And anyway, so coming all the way up to current day, I'm working with, I'm the SVP of Media Monks, as you mentioned. And so Media Monks, if for people who don't know, is a global agency production hybrid. So we're both ideating on the work, coming up with the strategies, working with all kinds of advertising and brand clients, but producing the work, creating everything. So I'm the head of real time. So you can imagine it's pretty interesting to sit within the mix of all of the tech clients and brand clients and hear everyone talk about Travis Scott and Fortnite, everything.
I want the marshmallow thing.
Yes.
You're like, yes. Yeah, but we want to build it on our own platform. You're like, but the whole idea is scale.
Yes. Yeah, audience is a big part of it. We can talk more about that, yeah. I'm sure, once Ollie chimes in here with all of his deep experience with audiences. But I think that's definitely key. That's definitely where my head is at right now, which is where are the audiences? Where are they living? And I think that's actually what I talk to our clients the most about, which is how to get there.
This is, I think, one of the often overlooked. You mentioned, you know, something interesting: creative, technical, and business. And those three are like the three stool, you know, legs of a stool. And if you kick one out, you know, you get just something really beautiful and technically beautiful, but nobody's going to use it. And so I think a lot of times, especially in early parts of technology, we sometimes forget the business aspect of it. And I know a lot of people who've made a lot of really cool stuff that's only been seen by a handful of people. So I think the business side of things. So with that, Ollie, I would love to get your backstory and how you got here. And I just, before you say that, I just want to punctuate that I got to go on the Lost Horizon stuff and watch all the videos. Oh my goodness, it's so cool. You worked with some friends of ours, Erez from Infected Mushroom. And we'll show that later, but yeah, super cool stuff that you're working on. Ollie, please take it away.
Yeah, so I'm a VR nerd from way back. I, as a teenager, when I was teaching myself to program on an Atari plugged into the TV, and I was reading books like Neuromancer and Snow Crash and watching movies like Tron, and, you know, got hooked on the sort of Star Trek Next Generation holodeck concept. So I've been waiting for VR or XR what we now sort of call XR for, you know, most of my life. I never really thought that I would have a chance to work in it because the technology was just crawling along at such a slow pace. I ended up, even though I had a background in music and throughout high school, music was actually my main focus. I ended up studying artificial intelligence at university in the 90s before it was cool. And that ended up being my golden ticket into the film industry. It's a long story that I'm not going to go into, but eventually as I was graduating, Peter Jackson announced he was making Lord of the Rings, and I finally knew what I wanted to be when I grew up. and the fact that I had studied artificial intelligence gave me kind of the grounding to be able to be the second ever user of a piece of software called Massive, which we used to build brains for orcs and elves and choreograph all the big battle scenes in the Lord of the Rings. And that kind of springboarded me into a career in visual effects. I spent sort of the next decade traveling around the world, working on a bunch of the biggest sort of film franchises out there, the Matrix trilogy, the Chronicles of Narnia, the Transformers, X-Men, all of that sort of stuff. But all that time, I was really waiting for VR to become a thing, because I'd recognized right from the get-go that being able to see the world through somebody else's eyes and experience it from their point of view would be a way to break down biases and, you know, help us to come together as a species, which is actually my overarching mission in life. But maybe there'll be time to touch on that a bit more later.
I think we should definitely touch on that for sure.
So 20 something years in the visual effects industry, and as soon as the Oculus Kickstarter came out, I realized that the moment was finally about to arrive, and I started diving into VR. And I'm not somebody who's particularly business-minded, but I think I have a pretty good balance of both creative and technical. And when I look at a new technology, or when I look at technology in the creative industries, I always think of it as that the technology and the art are sort of each enabling each other and pushing each other. So you'll get a spurt of technological advancement, which will enable a spurt of creative progress, which will, and so on and so on. So in the early days of VR, it was clear that what was missing was the ability to interact in VR, because the first Oculus headset was a headset with no controllers and you were supposed to still use your keyboard and mouse. I ended up developing a protocol to use the smartphone as a controller in VR. But that became quickly obsolete.
That's super nerdy, by the way.
Yeah.
that's up there with printing my own 3D rigs, my 3D camera rigs.
But to this day, still one of the most fun ways of moving around inside VR is like pinch zooming on your smartphone and sort of scaling the world around you.
It sounds like a recipe for the vomit comet.
If you're not careful, yeah. Anyway, I'm taking way too long with this sort of.
No, it's great. Story,
but I sort of bounced back and forth between VR technology and content. So I spent a few years working in the volumetric performance capture space, and that was actually when Tim and I first met. I think we were bidding on doing a volumetric capture for that Kygo project that you mentioned. I ended up writing and directing a couple of interactive VR films, including one that premiered at the Venice Biennale a couple of years ago. About 4 years ago, I got approached by a company called VR Jam in the UK. And back in those days, you know, years before the pandemic, we were thinking, how do you use VR to allow people to attend live music events that they can't physically attend, whether for, you know, reasons of just geography or might be physical disability or social discomfort, for whatever reason, you know, we want to be able to make live events accessible to people. So we developed a system to live stream motion capture. So for instance, we did shows where we'd have a DJ playing at the Ministry of Sound in London, and that DJ would be wearing a motion capture suit, and we would stream that motion capture live into a VR recreation of the club so that people could attend those gigs remotely.
I gotta say, having played at Ministry of Sound myself in the box, wow. I think it's gone now. I think it's condos, but that was a club. For those of you who have never been in the club, it was a very small room, actually. The box was small, but the two walls were just all speakers, floor to ceiling. Crazy.
Well, we're actually about to reinvigorate the virtual Ministry of Sound. So awesome. Look out for that coming up over the next few months.
Got to put an emulator in there, a virtual emulator into the virtual world.
There we go. And then, yeah, so as soon as the pandemic hit, of course, suddenly this business case for hybrid live and virtual events sort of pivoted into this need to recreate music events virtually entirely. So we partnered up with the team behind the Shangri-La section of Glastonbury Festival, and we built Lost Horizon in the Sansar platform. And in July last year, thanks, Ellen. Here's a little video from inside Sansar. And we're using some of the tricks of visual effects and virtual production to kind of bring real life performers into the virtual world. And then the audience is able to show up and, you know, dress up in an avatar, sort of customize their appearance and interact socially, have a full sort of recreation of a real life festival experience.
So cool.
Yeah, so at the moment, among a number of other projects, oh, there we go, Infected Mushroom, this one, fun show.
These guys actually performed using emulator at Coachella 1 year. And it's interesting that you took the game engine or this approach to live streaming events. Coachella back in 2014 or 15 live streamed in 360 the Coachella experience, and it was a great theory, but the streaming was so bad it was not practical. But this is super cool. Look at this.
Yeah, I mean, you have to stream a lot of video for 360 to be good enough resolution. Whereas these real-time things, you know, can be a lot less demanding on people's bandwidth.
Yeah, people don't realize it. Like this whole scene here, you know, how many polys would a scene like this be?
Tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, maybe.
But less than a million.
I would say less than a million. But when you start to add in all of the avatars.
That's when it adds up.
Yeah,
that touches on a really good point, Ollie. I wanted to ask you about this. Maybe this is part of the cross chat here, but often when we show up in these virtual events, there are only a handful of people on any given server instance. And this is certainly true within Fortnite. And given what John said earlier, which I totally agree with, all the money and resources that Epic and Fortnite have, they are not beyond having 50, 100 people join any given instance of the Fortnite Island. For example, the last weekend or the weekend before, they did Short Night, which was exactly what it sounds like. It was the short film festival on the Party Royale Island that you could join. And I went in and there was 50, maybe less, maybe 30 people there. But then within a couple of days, I saw the numbers on how many people attended, and it was 8 million over 2 days of a Saturday and Sunday. So my experience of it was not, oh wow, look at all these people here. It was like, okay, here's a handful of people, but clearly there were like millions of instances or hundreds of thousands of instances. So curious to get your opinion on that.
Yeah, that's a great question. And it is one of the things that prevents us from achieving the same level of a mass social event that you would have in real life. And I think it's going to be a while before we figure out ways to, but I think we will figure out ways to kind of pad out the people that are not in your immediate vicinity so that, you know, eventually you'll be able to feel like you're in a crowd of 100,000 people. Even though only
you need to fill it with NPCs.
Yeah. And we do that in the Sansar world as well, in Lost Horizon, and in a couple of another festival that I'm working on at the moment. There, you always have NPCs, but of course they have some geometry and textures to them as well. So, I think there will be ways to have sort of level of detail to allow you to feel like you're in a much bigger crowd.
I think that's a great point, actually, about, you know, actually saying, you know, how do you make you feel like you're in that? Because even if you go to Burning Man, You could say, well, how many people do you actually interact with? Well, let's call it 50. Well, that's like your instance in Fortnite or in any of these platforms. You know, the actual number of people that you're interacting with is that, but you feel like you're participating in something much better. And I think that, you know, you don't have to create an environment where you are literally interacting with millions of people, but you have to communicate what that feels like whilst interacting with people that you want to interact with.
Totally.
Yeah, and it's not necessarily the most important thing that makes these music experiences special.
Yeah, exactly. For what they are. Is that the ultimate goal?
It's,
you know, yeah.
it's one ingredient of it, yeah. Right? But arguably, you look at Travis Scott and Fortnite and Marshmello, which are the things that come up on every single phone call bingo around virtual events you could do with every single client. And I think the thing that I end up talking about with people is, okay, but you look at the successful test, you know, a test music piece, which that was, it's not that Fortnite was saying, oh, this is the holy grail of end, you know, this is the end of the line here. This is what everything should be. It's very much the beginning of the line, right? Of where this could go. But they do have in that Fortnite system skins and moves and emotes and other things that make it interesting. That is not about how many people are there, right? It's more about like, what other stuff are you doing? So that I think is where my mind goes, is like, what are the things that you are doing, which I'm sure, Ollie, you have a long list of things that you can do and not do.
For sure.
In the...
There's also a lot of practical benefits to not being in a crowd of 100,000 people. You know, being able to just go to the bathroom whenever you need to and find your friends again. Oh, being able to stand right in front of the stage. You know, in a real festival, there's only room for a few hundred people right in front of the stage, but in a virtual festival, everybody can be right in front of the stage. So it's also about, you know, recognizing how these virtual events allow us to decouple from reality to our benefit. You know, one of the popular things to do in a virtual event in Sanzar is, and it's something that an operator can sort of control dynamically, is to turn off or turn down gravity. And suddenly everybody can jump up into the scaffolding. And, you know, I've had some of the most interesting conversations that I've had in Lost Horizon were standing on top of a crane 300 feet above the dance floor, because me and some other person managed to both find their way up there.
That's amazing.
I think you make a really fundamental point here, because, you know, what these technologies do essentially is fundamentally change the relationship between the performer, if you have an artist, and the audience, and your relationship, you know, and experience of that, in ways that we are only just, you know, just starting to explore. But I think that's why it's so exciting and so interesting. So the things that are happening now are just like really tentative first steps as to what that could mean. And as I say, like, there's the reproduction of reality is one thing, but it's always, you know, I obviously work in a very much a photoreal realm, and, you know, working with David Bowie, you're recreating something that has existed historically in reality. But it really becomes interesting when you take that historical and photoreal reality and then expand it into a realm that is something else, something purely virtual, that is a hybrid, that offers you an experience that has never been, you know, done before.
So John, on that, yeah. Can you talk to this video here?
So that was that. So we've been building, so our David Bowie avatar has basically been our spearhead of sort of R&D for the last few years. Because, you know, when I was first working back with Dave Stewart, we were like, well, what if we could take an iconic performer and virtualize them? What would that actually mean? And at the time, you know, David was still around, but, you know, he subsequently passed away. And so it made it even more interesting to say, well, what would that mean to do that? So we were, you know, first built the first iteration of the avatar about 3 years ago, as this making of video shows. And then every year we've been revisiting that as the technology advances and also the potential use cases for it. So, you know, you know, we're talking about various things that we're doing with the avatar. I can't really talk about too much right now, but but it's advancing what you can do within this space. So, you know, if you can do it with David Bowie, you can do it with other performers, and, you know, really sort of experiment as to see what that could look like and what could be the business and artistic opportunities that would.
Whoa, have. Hold on. Hold the phone. There it is. Did anybody notice that his eyes are different colors?
Well, it's interesting with David, because actually his eyes weren't different colors. It's you know, it's really, a lot of this stuff is a real rabbit hole that you can go around. It's about
perception. Love it.
You know, his eyes, he had an accident when he was hit in the face when he was about 11. And so the eye of his left eye is constantly dilated. And that was what has made David Bowie so iconic and sort of alien-like. And people often think his eyes are different colors. Actually, they're not different colors. They're just different ways in which the iris is reflecting light based on the radius of the pupil. But
wow, that's so cool. I just caught it. And I was like, wait a second. I didn't know that. But now you tied it all together.
Yeah. So a lot, I mean, Bowie's a kind of unique proposition in a way, because what you're doing is you're recreating essentially a simulation of somebody that existed. You know, it's not like, you know, making an avatar of somebody that exists now and then animating it using that live performance. You know, you're basically taking, you know, a model of somebody that existed and using as much data as you can get to kind of make that as accurate as possible. And then getting an alternative performer to mimic, mime, interpret their performance. You know, you train them, you work with that performer, and then you have the processor. That's the sort of raw motion capture, facial capture data that you have to work with. And then you're, you know, working with animators to animate that performance to really dial in what Bowie would do and what that would look like. So it's a very, very granular process at every single level, and a very specific problem to, you know, what that is to recreate a performer. You know, this is obviously David Bowie's Ziggy Stardust from 1972, 1973. So, you know, what are the specific problems related to, you know, resurrecting or, you know, bringing that character back to life in terms of the way it looks, the way it performs, you know, on a whole different, you know, variety of levels. So, you know, but, you know, working with digital avatars, it's like, you know, each one presents its own unique set of problems, really. And also the set of problems in relation to what you're actually going to do with it. You know, what platform you're going to release this on? What is the specific experience? You know, is this just a rendered video, or is this an interactive, you know, concert that is quote unquote live or like live? So, as I say, it's a whole bowl of spaghetti that you kind of have to get into with every single equation.
Great. Love it.
Maybe that's a good way segue, Alan, because I wanted to show the audience a little bit of the Pokemon Post Malone project. And the reason why I said that as a segue is because, John, what you're saying there about the definition of the end deliverable, meaning is it live? What are you actually doing with it? This came up a lot with the Pokemon Post Malone project. So this launched this last weekend. We Media Monks were working with a group of people. The director, Jason Zada, did an amazing job on this. It was a long-running project, as you can imagine, to celebrate Pokemon's 25th anniversary year, which it is this year, which as probably a lot of people saw, because they've been shouting about it. And they brought Post Malone, the Pokemon client, and an agency, Mediacom, brought Post Malone and Pokemon together. And so this last weekend was a 15-minute fully animated live show, which we put out on YouTube and Twitch as programmed content. Be there this time, this place, see it exclusively. And then a whole bunch of kind of activity around it, you know, talking about the Pokemons and seeing them in new ways. And so it's kind of a mashup of two different worlds. What I think is really interesting in this context is the piece, which is 13 minutes, is Post Malone performing, mocap driven from beginning to end with no edits, no breaks. It's his performance of five songs, one of which is a Hootie and a Blowfish cover, which has caused a bunch of news and press. People have a lot of opinions about that. You can Google it. And so I think our job here creatively was to obviously work with the group, design a character, build worlds. This is all built in Unreal Engine. So it's what Unreal Engine would call as close to final pixel as possible, meaning I'm sure this audience knows what that means, but to get, you know, the least amount of compositing and post-production between engine and your final piece. There's some transitions for sure where we're definitely merging from one world to the next creatively. But I think we were happy with how we were able to bring him and Jason Zada and Alexander Ray and the whole creative team. We're happy with the focus of how do you kind of bring him to life, make it feel realistic, go a step further beyond some of the other CG performances we've already seen, which were already great in the space. You know, the work that the Wave VR has been doing with John Legend is worth noting. You know, other people.
We have to drop the VR from the Wave.
Yes, sorry. Did I say VR? Wave, yes, Wave. The Wave. So yeah, I think this is part of the mix, right? Of how are these shows created, to John's point? How are they created? How are they put out into the world? What is the main reason? And the one, this particular approach was all about getting the highest possible quality experience with as many of the Pokemons as we can get in there, and also have it go to a Post Malone audience that is expecting, you know, a show, expecting AAA quality show, for want of a better term. Of course, you know, you could do the fully interactive version of this, right, in your world, Ollie, and then you would bring the LODs down and you would target things in a different way. You know, we would love to do that too, but it's a different animal for sure.
Mm-hmm. And I think different that Pokemon actually you punctuated something there, Tim and John. The medium defines the technology a lot of times, because if you want this to run on, let's say, an Oculus Quest, it's not going to look like this. It'll have similarities. It'll be green, but you're not going to have foliage that is, you know, this clear and, you know, these types of shadows. And so when you're building these things, you know, are you building them for, you know, for video reproduction or, you know, kind of the idea that people are going to be consuming this on a phone or a tablet or a computer versus, you know, in a VR headset? And, you know, I guess the question around scale, you know, how do you, when you have Post Malone and Pokemon, you're looking at millions and millions of people. But if you, that's like everybody in VR would have to go into it in order to do that. So how are you getting around the clients that say, hey, we want to do this in VR and only VR? And what are the conversations around that? Maybe we'll start with you all.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question, and it's a very sort of important subject, I think, for this panel, is, you know, reaching the audience where they actually are. And there's a few different parts to that. One is, you know, what hardware people have access to. And obviously, everybody in the world has access to a smartphone. A fraction of those people have access to a gaming PC powerful enough to run some of these real-time engines, much less a VR headset. So, for instance, if we go back to the original Lost Horizon festival last summer, we had about 1,000 people attend in VR, about 9,000 people attend between the PC desktop and smartphone app that Sansar offers. And then we had something like 4.5 million people watching stream views. So we had people inside the VR world, not actually in VR typically, we had people inside the real-time world. Oh, nice. I haven't seen this video. we had people inside the real-time world operating cameras, either jumping between predefined fixed camera positions.
Oh, so that would be a camera person right there, I think, actually. Yeah, is this a camera person?
No, I think that's just somebody with one.
With a cool head. Never mind.
Yeah.
But you actually had people wandering around as cameras.
Exactly. So all of this footage that we're watching now from inside Sansar was captured live with somebody sort of screen capturing their own experience, what their engine was rendering for them. So yeah, so there's the ability to reach people on these different sort of hardware platforms. There's also the ability to reach people on these different social platforms. So, you know, Sansar has spent years building their platform and building up their audience and building up a fan base of people who have an avatar that they've customized in Zanzar and have a network of friends that they've met and accumulated inside Zanzar. Meanwhile, you've got over here a different silo of people who have been, you know, playing Fortnite for years and have built up their friend circle in Fortnite. So there's a whole other aspect to this, which is something that I'm exploring again with VR Jam, is ways to, for the same live experience, to be beamed into multiple different platforms to reach the fans where they are and where they already have their social circles.
Yeah, it reminds me a little bit of the mobile app ecosystem, right? And how these things have grown up over time. And what's that? That's like 10 plus years old, the app ecosystem, maybe close to 15. And it's there's a bunch of walled gardens, there's a bunch of kind of more open source places. Hopefully we get to the even with the business strategies that everyone has, hopefully we get to the point where there is some cross-platform cross-pollination going on, because that definitely feels like a restrictive factor here that is helping certain companies and maybe not others, you know, like to get to a point where you actually can join, let's say, a Burning Man or a Coachella or a Glastonbury in a couple of, or maybe in six different platforms, wherever you want to get in there, you know, that.
Well, I think that's a great example. The Burning Man last year was on 12 different platforms.
Oh yeah, that was crazy. I was in it on Engage, in AltSpace, a bunch of ones I don't remember, but yeah, I went and kind of Burning Man was, so, you know, I've been reading a lot. I know GamesBeat had a whole seminar on the metaverse, you know, what is the metaverse? And I was very fortunate to read Snow Crash early, and we named our company Metaverse. So, you know, we get the added benefit of everybody saying it all the time, it's spelled differently, but they had this whole talk on the future of the metaverse. And, you know, I'm watching, you know, the CEO of Epic Games, and I'm watching, you know, all these people talk about the metaverse, and I'm sitting there going, you know what? We already have the metaverse, it's called the internet. We just, you know, we just decided to wall it all off and block it all off and put app stores in between the internet. We have the metaverse, it's called the internet. We are all connected to it. So now we just need to make these tools work everywhere. And it's actually, it's funny because we're building a game engine. We built a game engine, and our whole ethos is that it has to work. When you hit the publish button, it has to work on every device, cell phones, smart, you know, computers, tablets, everything, VR, AR glasses. And I think, you know, the devices are getting way more powerful. You know, the phone that I have today, you know, is rendering basically the same as what I was running on a 1080 video card 5 years ago. And, you know, in fast forward 3 years from now, and Mac's M1 chip is going to be on your phone. So, you know, the technology on the devices is just, you know, accelerating beyond the capabilities. So I think, you know, if you look forward, let's say 5 years, where do you see these concerts and these virtual events evolving to, with the idea that you can be on a phone in real time and also be in a, you know, a, let's say a Vario VR headset with a, you know, 3090 Ti video card powering it? You know, where do you see, I guess, the happy medium where you have the scalability of devices like phones and computers, but also the immersiveness of the glasses and visors?
I mean, I think cloud compute solutions are probably going to be the thing that bridges that, you know, because if your internet latency is low enough, whether you're on 5G or...
you just nailed the problem though. If your internet latency is good enough, so there's like 1% of us can use it.
Sure, but I think internet infrastructure is easier to democratize than you know, high-powered computing in terms of, you know, I don't think my grandmother is ever going to have a dual 3090 Ti workstation.
We should hope not.
But she might have, you know, a next generation Wi-Fi hub that allows her on her crappy little smartphone to have that full rendering solution by connecting to that hardware on the cloud.
It's interesting. We're seeing a lot of this pixel streaming happening. I know Unity's offering it in terms of their Forma product, and I know there's a company called PureWeb that does it, and most notably would be, I guess, Google Stadia. They're, you know, offering Pixel streaming, and I think they just pulled the plug on the studio side of Stadia, but I think Stadia itself is still going as a going concern. I'm pretty sure they are too. I have a pretty fast internet connection, pretty, you know, pimped out computer, and I tried to play a video game on Stadia and it was great. You know, I'm like playing Call of Duty on a, you know, on a laptop over a browser. I'm like, this is amazing. And then it wasn't. And then it all just went pixelated. And I'm like, I'm going to shoot somebody. And then all of a sudden they're way over there. And I'm like, oh, this is not a gamer's. This is any gamer who wants to play, you know, and you point at somebody and shoot at them, they, you know, you hit them. When you point and then you shoot and they're over here now, it's not acceptable. And so where do you see kind of, I guess that if you're going to go, you know, the route of pixel streaming, how do we, I guess 5G really addresses that for the mobile market, but, and, you know, kind of maybe Wi-Fi 6 addresses that. So I think it's more of a technology thing.
Well, I'm not sure it's a technology thing, more of a business thing, because, you know, all of these platforms are run by very, very powerful companies. You know, you've got silos. And I think what we're going to be seeing is a sort of silo war. Is a, you know, Facebook, Google, Apple, Amazon, they're at some level they're aligned with each other, but in other levels they're very much competing against each other. And what, you know, Facebook is doing with Oculus and Oculus Quest is creating their own ecosystem of users that they very much want to retain. I mean, that is their business model. So, you know, although open source and open web solutions are great, I'm just not sure that the companies that have the power and the muscle to really push these things are going to take it in that direction. You're going to have like great, great ecosystems within the Facebook ecosystem. You're going to have great, great, you know, stuff within the Apple ecosystem. But so I don't know. I think it's very interesting. I think it both
helps. I'd agree. Adoption,
you know,
I'd agree with you, John.
You make a great point. Sorry, I'm just going to punctuate John's point. You make a really great point about that, because one of the most obvious things that's occurred in the last, I guess, year and a half is Apple's bifurcation of the 3D model standardization. So the Kronos group got everybody together at a table and said, we're going to go, you know, the new JPEG of 3D is going to be GLTF and we're all going to forward. And Apple was on board, everybody's on board. And then all of a sudden Apple's like, nah, we're going to use USDZ. And so now they've bifurcated the entire system. That's like me saying, hey, send me a photo. And you're like, oh, what format would you like that photo in? Okay, you've got PNG, SVG, you've got, you know, 100 formats. But a photo is a JPEG, like, and anything that I read, we have a universal readers for these. If you send me an SVG, it'll open up. If you send me a JPEG, we don't have that in 3D yet. And you know, one of the biggest challenges is that there's no standardization around 3D model formats, and no way to kind of easily manage those. And it's getting better. I was on a talk yesterday with Kronos Group, and you know, they're pushing their OpenXR standards, and you know, but without Apple, you have no standard. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I'm, you know, having worked in the visual effects industry for 20 years, I mean, those sort of standards and conventions is such an important part of interoperability between different artists and different studios. So I totally see the need for standards. I'm not going to weigh in on the GTLF versus USDZ, but I do think that, you know, whatever becomes the standard, and there does need to be a unified standard, it's going to be the equivalent of PDF. You know, a few years ago, there wasn't, before PDF came along, you know, there wasn't a cross-platform, cross-software way of viewing a text and image file in a way that was consistent. And then the PDF came along, and now everybody assumes that, you know, that certain types of documents are just going to be shared in PDF. And for the 3D, the spatial future that we are now entering, there's going to need to be an equivalent of PDF. I'm not going to weigh in other than to say, you know, I do think that the USD does have sort of a better hierarchical structure and a way of representing bigger scenes, whereas GTLF is more about sort of individual objects and parts.
So it's interesting you say that, because we developed our own 3D model format as well. And it, we took the kind of the best of GLTF and the best of USDZ, so we can embed video textures and animation, like, you know, a lot more depth of information embedded in that. Because, you know, for people who are looking to build these things, you know, I think there's a lot of, oh, we'll just, you know, throw it together in a 3D world. But, you know, each of those avatars consists of probably the avatar itself. So maybe it's an OBJ model or GLTF. Then you've got all your texture files, and then you've got your, you know, your maps and everything, your UV maps. And so, you know, one 3D, simple 3D object can have 6, 7, 10 files associated with it. And I think this is, when people go to build these things, they're assuming that it's going to be as easy as drag and drop with Photoshop. And I think there's a huge learning curve around just getting started for people. So maybe some advice around you guys, you know, where do you think people should get started creating these virtual worlds if they were interested in this? And where do you think they should go to kind of cut their teeth on this?
Yeah, I wanted to pick up on what John was saying earlier before as well. I'll definitely answer that too. But I agree with you, John, about the silo wars and the big, you know, economics with our big tech friends in Facebook and Google and everyone. But I think the flip side to that is, you know, look at what Microsoft launched yesterday or the day before. Yep. With Mesh and some of the things that they were showing. There's this innovation element which we wouldn't get if none of these Yep. companies cared, right? And I think the the cloud comment is right for sure. That's definitely part of this. It just all moves slightly slower than we would all like as people on the forefront of this. And it's frustrating probably for us and everyone who's watching that you see this incremental change. But actually for someone who's not working in it, they paying attention every year to how much change there is. It's pretty big year on year, the amount of increase we see. And I think the question will be, when can you get that David Bowie with all those levels of details in and have 10 of them around you and then a wider crowd, and you know how much level of details. Even when you look at AAA gaming, that's still already a ceiling there on how far you can go, let alone when we're talking about cloud or mobile or any of this, you know? So I just wanted to talk about that because I think what Microsoft are doing, you know, often we count out on any given year, we count, you know, big tech companies in and out of this conversation. And then they come back in with something like this and you're like, look what they've been working on behind the scenes for the last year, you know, when everyone was like, HoloLens 2, it's only for enterprise. What are we going to do with this? But then they come out with this and you're like, well, that's amazing. You know, there's a lot
and
of
like, hey, Alex Kipman's been busy.
Yes. Yeah. And they're so big, these groups. So the software dev that's going on, you know, we all saw what happened with Magic Leap and all the hard work they did. It's not easy to crack these problems. It just really isn't. And you know, so I'm just really happy that you have the big tech companies doing it. And then you also have Unreal Engine and Unity working so hard to work on some of those standards. Yes, it's still a work in progress, but those guys are going to go a long way to helping us get there for sure, which is a segue to training and where to start, because actually we worked with Epic and we work with Unity too. We have partnerships with everyone, but we worked with Epic recently to create how to get into advertising through 3D and through Game Engine. And we put together some materials around Oreo and around brand pieces and pack shots. And the idea for Epic, they frame it as Unreal Futures. And there'll be a whole bunch of training they're giving people. And as everyone here knows, they're working hard to invest back into the community to get more and more people trained up in 3D. I'm pretty impressed by all the training they have at all the different levels. Yeah, this
I'll
is
put
it.
I will drop the link in the chat. So here it is here, Unreal Futures, create your first 3D advertisement in Unreal Engine. Is that the one?
Yeah, it's simple. It's a simple tutorial video led with some sample projects. And I think, you know, wider than us at Media Monks doing this, you also look at what they released recently with Moment Factory, with the DMX sample that they released last week.
Oh yeah,
that was really Unity interesting.
Just did one with Volvo. They released a car configurator with all the assets.
Those are amazing. And I think then Weta, Ollie, you'll probably know the people who worked on that. Weta released a Meerkat one with Epic, I wanna say end of year, beginning of year, which had all the groom on the Meerkat, the animation that they'd done. Those samples are amazing places to start, I think.
Yeah, I think you've hit the nail on the head, Tim. You know, I've Worked with both Unity and Unreal as well. Recently completed the Unreal Virtual Production Fellowship, as a matter of fact. I have to say that there's just no excuse for anybody who's interested in getting into this stuff. There's no excuse to not have already started. Those softwares are free. They're, you know, Blender is free. You can get all of the software that you need, and all of the tutorials that you need are available on YouTube or through the training sites of the software that you're looking for. So really, I think the one thing that is the sort of the core of real-time content creation is iteration. And you can only start iterating once you've started. So to anybody that wants to get into it, just get into it. What are you doing watching this talk? Download the software now and start.
Yes. They're getting inspired. Actually, it's interesting. I'll find it here. I wrote an article on how to get into the XR industry. I will post it. I'll put it in the chat.
Yeah, and more, maybe John, you can talk to this as well. More and more, we were all a VR obsessed, which I still am in a lot of ways. And then obviously it widened to XR with so many different tool sets and AR in mixed reality in the heart of that. But actually a lot of the conversations I'm having are back to generally 3D across video and imagery and previs and back to mobile. And so I'm kind of enjoying how much wider it is than it was a few years ago. Maybe this is driven by people like Epic too, being wide for sure, talking about virtual production, as you just showed with The Mandalorian, that cooked up a whole filmmaking conversation for sure in the last 6 months.
Well, that's why when I was working on Call of Duty, I said I wasn't so much a gamer, but I was working in a game environment. I was a movie screenwriter, and I thought, why aren't we making movies like this, you know? And so that's happening slowly in very interesting ways. It takes its time, and like any entertainment system, it actually is not about innovation. You know, innovation is, people don't want necessarily innovation, but when the innovation becomes so compelling and so cost effective, you have to kind of prove that it works, and that's happening right now. So that's super exciting. And I think that helps accelerate the whole thing, like making a 2D movie or a 2D video using 3D tools, real-time tools. It's not real-time and it's not 3D, but that's where most of the world views stuff. That's how you reach consumers. That's how you reach an audience. But the 2D becomes a portal to the 3D and the interactive. And if the tools are there, then the portal will open up and it gets super exciting. But no, I really think that the best thing to advance 3D and interactive is 2D and non-interactive.
It's a really good point. It's a really good point, because I would say my observation is one of the great things about real time is not going anywhere, because the economics of it are proving out that you can do things cheaper with the right people. You know, you have to have the right team who actually have had a second to actually learn their craft. But once they're actually doing the work, there is, time and labor to be saved doing it in an engine. That's a huge point, because I think that means that we will continue to see it grow. Like you said earlier, Alan, it's Photoshop of the future, as opposed to this innovation piece that's going to be in headsets, you know? I think it's worth everyone's time to look into it and learn it for sure.
We just launched this morning, actually. So
this is cool.
This is our virtual showroom. So the idea with this is that it is, real time. You can, look at things, zoom in, zoom out, change the colors, interact, and it's all real time. You can buy it, buy directly from the scene. You can watch videos.
Is this sponsored by Puma?
It's not, no.
This looks great.
They're one of our clients we were aiming for, so yeah. And then, you can have 3D animations built into it. And so just, the idea with this is that right now it's a singular user, but we're about to push an update where it could be multiple people. So you could have it doesn't need to be a retail environment. It could be a concert, and you can have a few people walking around together. Now, again, you're limited by the number of people you can have, but the fact that it's real time and anybody can do it. Oops, I'm stuck behind a jacket here. But you know, you can start to have videos embedded in your texture files and stuff. And this was all made over the course of a weekend, because our engine is all code optional and drag and drop now. So anyway, I just wanted to share that because I thought
that looks great. People might
like it. And there's audio as well. When I click this, the guitar plays really loud in my ears.
And is this optimized for mobile, Alan?
Works on an iPhone 6 and above. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We that was our whole ethos, is that it has to work on everything. And, you know, you have some trade-offs. You know, we can't have fur. We don't have explosions. But we have, you know, as clear as you can get it with, you know, on a phone that's, you know, 6 or 7 years old. So this is a, you need to have the ability to get to everybody. To your point, John, you know, people are looking at all of these things on a 2D device. They're looking, you know, most people are viewing them on a 2D device, a phone, tablet, computer. And so as, you know, VR and AR glasses become more mainstream over the next, I would say, 5 years, we'll go phone to face, is my prediction, kind of 5 to 7 years. And as these things happen, the technology is the same technology. 3D is 3D, whether you do it, you know, for a AAA game or you do it for, you know, for a web experience. But being able to distribute it through the web and bypassing all the app stores, you know, there's a benefit to that, you know, and I think that's punctuated by Epic's lawsuit against Apple and Google at the same time. So, you know, we're seeing a major, I guess, shift in the industry and how people are accepting, you know, this 30% is a lot of money if you're a developer, right? You know, if you're a developer making something, 30% right off the top, that's like your margin on these things. So I think there's going to be some upheaval around those things.
There's the other end of the equation I just wanted to point out that sort of has been sort of stymied by the pandemic, but location-based VR, I'm a huge believer in presenting to consumers a way to access really, really high-level VR and what that experience is, because, you know, you can have ticketed events, you know, site-specific sort of, you know, VR things where you just go and purchase a ticket and see the most amazing VR experience. I think the consumers and the public need to have that in their head and be have access to that experience in order to really see where all this is going. And that's a viable business model too, especially as the, hopefully, you know, the pandemic comes to a close or we're suddenly able to open up those things. But I think that's an important arena to really show what can be done. And there can be a business model around that too.
But the pandemic has shown us that people really want to spend time in experiences, and that, you know, when you took that away from the world, it was really, really clear when you talked to everyone how quickly. So I think we're clearly going to see a resurgence of experiential and pop-ups and activations, and for a year or two, you know, beyond reopening, whatever, whenever that is for everyone. And whether VR is part of that, I think it's interesting because it's a tactile thing, right? You're putting a headset on your face. So the question is, there is, are people going to feel comfortable? I think as we're seeing now with vaccinations and everything, I think this will all just plateau out and everyone's just going to be happy that it's safe again, you know? But screens are part of that, you know?
I think another thing that the pandemic has done, and this panel notwithstanding, is kind of increase access and diversity. I think one of our at Lost Horizon and VR Jam, one of our guiding principles is, you know, trying to make our events as accessible to people as possible. People of all sort of diverse backgrounds and who want to represent themselves, how they want to represent themselves. So I think there's a certain portion of the audience and of the market that is going to continue to use you know, virtual ways of attending the events because of the accessibility factor, and also because of the climate footprint. Because, you know, a million people showing up to a concert in VR does no damage to the planet compared to a million people driving and flying and getting there by other sort of carbon polluting means. So, you know, There are a lot of other positive factors that the sort of virtual events bring that I hope outlive the pandemic.
I think that's true. I definitely saw clients asking about virtual events. We Media Monks pivoted a lot of experiential activations to virtual events and have a broadcast and a live group. Some of the savvy clients will say, how many servers is it taking to make this content? You know, what are people's overheads like? And it's good to see that, you know, like it's not comparable to doing it in real life to doing it virtually, but it's good to see people saying, oh, actually, how many, you know, and that'll be the cloud thing again. It's like, well, how many servers in Norway are really running this cloud event so 8 million people can go to Burning Man versus 8 million people driving to, you know, the actual place, the player. So it won't be comparable, I'm sure, but it's good to see people talking about it.
Absolutely. And yes, obviously, I was oversimplifying by suggesting that a virtual event has no carbon footprint. Of course it does, but it's considerably less.
Yeah. Alan, it's we're probably over fraction. Time and talking.
We're probably we talking are. We, we are over time. I got totally sidetracked here. So exciting. The stuff you guys are just mind-boggling. I can't wait to meet you guys in person and live life in real life a little bit. As much as we're talking about the virtual thing, there is no replication for a real event. And I think that's, you know, something we can all agree on. But there's lots of reasons to have these virtual events. And I think what we may see in the future is this hybrid of, you know, virtual event or real events where they have a virtual version of it so that, you know, you have the real Coachella and then you have virtual Coachella. And maybe there's a blend between where you can kind of pop your head in a window and, you know, you're standing on stage, you know, at Coachella, you're like, whoa, that's cool. You know, I think there's going to be a lot of these things. So, and somebody puts hybrid and location-based soon. I actually saw something this morning from Kevin Williams, who's a VR location-based genius. And he posted something, I was trying to find it. But what it is somebody has taken, it's COVID safe location-based VR. And basically it's containers, you know, the 20 by 20 foot containers. They just take a 20 foot container, empty, put some, you know, Vive trackers in the corner, and now you've got your own solitary VR experience. And so containers are cheap. You can pick them up for a couple $100. And so I think maybe that's one way of doing it. You know, getting people.
Yeah, safe. It's amazing.
Yeah. And I think, you know, we saw the demise of The Void and some other large location-based entertainment companies because of the pandemic. But I think, you know, there's going to be room for that as well, because not everybody's going to want to buy a $500 blaster and a, you know, a vibrating suit and some haptic gloves and, you know, all these things that go along, or scent machines and, you know, all of these things that really, really make the high-end experience something worth paying for. And I think we're going to see a massive surge of this in the next kind of 5 years. So I think, you know, the bets that were made a couple of years ago, they didn't pan out, but I think there's going to be a massive resurgence of this. And I expect to see you guys as part of most of those things, or at least some of them. So I'm excited.
I hope so.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you. I think we've come to the end here. We'll take a few questions if we can. And then if you guys want to answer or ask some questions, feel free to do so in the chat or the Q&A here. Just use the chat, actually. It's much easier.
We have one about VR headsets, I think.
Sure. Do you want to? I don't see it. So do you want to just take it?
Yeah, yeah. Anonymous attendee asked, from a consumer perspective, if we're going to invest in a VR device, which would you recommend? John replied in and said, probably Oculus Quest. I think that is true.
Quest 2.
For sure.
Quest 2.
Yes.
The white one. Quest 2. Not the Quest 3. It's not out yet. But I would definitely buy the Quest 3 when it comes out.
I misheard. I thought you said Plus 2. But yes, I think we would all agree that the Oculus Quest 2 is the headset that it makes sense for people to buy at this stage.
It makes no sense not to buy it, actually, because you can still, if you want the full resolution, you can stream it now directly from your PC with your 3090 in it, and you have a seamless experience over Wi-Fi. And so it makes no sense to buy anything else at this point right now. You know, I think HTC is playing catch up with when it comes to standalone, but they're also really focused on the Chinese market. So we'll see what comes over there.
And yeah, speaking of pixel streaming, Pluto Sphere have announced a product where you'll be able to stream from a cloud workstation to your Oculus Quest to do full if you don't happen to have a gaming PC at home. So
sweet. Here, I'll drop that link into the chat. You're getting all sorts of good stuff here, guys. So is there any other questions before we go? I think we should, make it available to you guys. The last chance to ask questions. No. Okay. Going once, going twice. Oh, your article. I don't know what that means. Jesse, what is
it? I think you posted it earlier.
The article's in there. So just chat, just copy the whole chat and you will have it there. It's in there further up. I'll repost it for you, but yeah, the article's there. Final thoughts, guys. I want to ask you one final question. And I run a podcast called the XR for Business podcast, and we've interviewed everybody about the business applications. But my final question is, and I'll ask you each individually, what is the ultimate goal, or I guess, what is the ultimate challenge to the world that you want to see solved using XR technologies, and why? Ollie, you look like you're ready to go.
I'll take a crack at that. I think that the sort of selfishness and individualism of our current political and economic climate is the one challenge that needs to be overcome. It's what underpins the racial justice crisis. It's what underpins the environment crisis. It's what underpins the wealth inequality crisis. And all of those things are coming to a head. I think we are approaching a point in human history where we'll either have a peaceful revolution or a violent one. And I really am optimistic that that immersive social connective experience can be the platform by which we come together as a species and tackle challenges that are facing us.
Amazing.
Yeah, I'll add to that. Obviously, there's nothing to disagree with there, Ollie. But climate. You know, we're all so focused on the pandemic, but I think the climate is the biggie. And I think next year and the year after and the year after, that's the conversation that's gonna dominate. So it's good to see lots of content projects, influencers, VIPs, all weighing in. We're seeing briefs around that, which I'm glad to see already from organizations, from advertising, from commercials, but you know, people are just more and more aware of it. So yeah, definitely gonna do our side. And S4, which is, I'll be corporate for a second, the S4 group, which owns MediaMonks, was the first non-corporate, it was the first advertising brand company to sign the Amazon pledge, which is a pledge to get all carbon emissions down within actually 2040, but we'd already committed to an earlier date. So I think it's good to see companies just make public commitments, you know, because it's part of the culture, you know, just make the commitment and do it, you know. But now we have a good president over here in the US, maybe that helps too. Mic drop.
I think it's important that this is all about connection, you know. There's this talk of the virtual world, we go into our own virtual little bubble and disappear, and you know, the goal for me is always, what is the user experience? How do we connect as human beings together? You know, I deal with digital human avatars, but my question is always like, well, how does that enrich real human experience and real relationships? You know, if we can't get on planes and, you know, gather in groups, you know, what is the alternative, or what is a better solution, you know, both for socially, psychologically, and environmentally, because it's not always the best idea environmentally to have people all be getting together on jumping on planes and all the rest of it. So I think we should always keep that in mind, how to keep it real in the virtual.
John, it's interesting you said those three things, because my personal mission in life is to inspire and educate future leaders to think and act in a socially, economically, and environmentally sustainable way. Mm-hmm. I've been repeating that to myself for the last 6 years every day. And I think we've managed to inspire some people on this webinar. So thank you guys very much for your time. Thank you to SparkFX for putting this on. And thank you for everybody for attending. This has been a fantastic one. I can't wait for more content to come out of your studios. I'm looking forward to it. And let's jump in the virtual worlds and have a party together soon.
Great. Thank you, Alan.
All right. Bye, everybody. Thank you so much, everybody.
Take care.
Bye. Cheers. Bye.